Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Startup Grind. So, thanks for coming. I'm going to give you a quick background about Startup Grind. Startup Grind is an event series. We're based out of the US and we're powered by Google. We have 100 chapters across the globe. We host entrepreneurs of renown every month to share their stories, experiences, how they're going about it and all that. So this month we have Rahu of Taxi for Sure. I'm sure his company needs no introduction to any of you, but I'll go ahead and introduce you. He is the co-founder of Taxi for Sure, one of, I think, the hottest startups in India today. He is actually an NITK Suratkar graduate and an IIM alumni. He, along with his classmate and friend Radhakrishna, started Taxi for Sure in 2011. And from a very small, I think, bootstrap mode, they have come up to now being the second largest taxi company in the country. They operate over 7,000 taxis with over 400 taxi operators across six cities, and they're going to open up another 30 cities over the next 1 year. And I think as of yesterday, they raised around $30 million funding, and total of over a 3 year period, they have raised around $45 million. So I think he's an inspiration to all of us. Can I give it up for Rahul?
Thank you, guys. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for having us here.
Our pleasure, Rahul. So just to let you know, this is more of a Q&A, very interactive session. So why don't we start off a little bit about your background? Is there anything in your background that made you lean towards an entrepreneurial tendency? Because you did work in Texas Instruments and other places for a couple of years. So I think total of 5-6 years you worked elsewhere before starting Taxi for Sure. Is there anything that made you quit your job and start off?
Good question. Actually, so the background is I'm a computer science engineer. I used to code for Texas Instruments. I used to be a chip designer. I don't know how many people are into semiconductors now. I used to be a chip designer. Anyone into semiconductors here?
Was.
Great. So post that, I did my MBA, and after that, I used to work as a consultant for a company called Feedback Ventures. There, I used to be part of the infrastructure advisory division. I used to advise government on where to open nuclear power plants, where to open hydroelectric power plants, which roads to be converted into a super fast expressway and stuff like that. From a 65 nanometer technology work, I moved to a nuclear power plant kind of work, right? So, looking at that, I don't think so anywhere. Because I couldn't start a nuclear power plant. And I couldn't probably design a chip myself, right? So there, I'm not really sure I had something there. But what I, personally speaking, I run a lot of marathons, right? I think so persevering and the determination to complete the race when I started pretty early. I started running in 2006. I started running marathons in 2006. So then people used to think that there were a bunch of psychos, right? So I was in Ahmedabad then, and the only time we used to get to practice running was 2 a.m. in the morning. So we used to run from 2 a.m. in the morning till 4:30, then come back, take bath and sleep, and then wake up for the classes at 7:30, right? So people used to see us on the road at 2 a.m. in the morning running, and they used to think that what is wrong with these guys. There were a bunch of six people, and strangely, all the six people turned out to be entrepreneurs. Right, I think that's one. The second thing could be, I always played team sports. Right, I never played individual games. I mean, I used to play carrom, chess and stuff like that, but most importantly, I used to play cricket for my universities or the companies that I work with. Right, so I think when you are playing a team sport, right, so there, if there's a captain, right, the captain need not be the star player of the match, right? And if you have a star batsman, if that batsman fails, the rest of the people will not say that, okay, the star batsman has failed, why should I bat? Someone will raise up to the occasion. I think that is very, very critical and very, very relevant for a starter. If someone else is not able to deliver, someone has to pitch in. If you're playing football, right, the defender will not say that I will not cross the middle line. It's a forward who has to score the goal. Right, when the ball is there, people will run. But everyone has the responsibility. If the opposition gets the ball, the defender who runs back has this, not the forward guy. I think so. Playing a team sport really, really helps when you become an entrepreneur, right? So that you don't really wait for people to deliver. If people are struggling with something, then other people should pitch in, and no one asks any questions. People know that some days if a star batsman fails, you don't essentially say that what are you doing. If it consistently fails, then you have an issue. But one or two matches he fails, you don't really have an issue. I think those are something that would really help.
And coming to your taxi for sure. So how did you conceptualize the whole thing? Because you try to, you know, I think recreate or innovate the entire taxi industry. And that's a very fragmented industry. You have players like Meru who wanted to own all the taxis, which obviously is very capital intensive. You went for the asset light model where you use technology to do that. What got you to do that?
Yeah, frankly, all this understanding came much after we started Taxi Fashion. So the disrupting the taxi industry or getting to an asset-like model is not what we thought. I mean, it's very, very difficult to imagine an MBA who was a consultant not to think through the whole thing completely, but do something and later on say that, oh, we did this and this is an asset-like model, right? So how the idea of Taxi for Sure started was, Aparamaya, my partner, and I, both of us are very in a travel-heavy job. I used to be a consultant. Aparamaya used to be a head of business development. So we used to travel a lot. Right? So I used to be in there, I used to work out of Delhi. So at 5 p.m. in the evening, you call up Meru Cabs. Right? Your call number 25, approximate waiting time is 20 minutes. No one wants to wait for 20 minutes to get to speak to a call center person. Right? So, but what we realized simultaneously was there was a free Meru car on the road, which was ready to provide the service. There was a customer who was ready to have the service. Just because the call center was a bottleneck, they are not able to get in touch with each other. Then we thought, what are the calls people actually do? They ask the customer the pickup location and they figure out whether there are any cabs in that area or not. If they find a cab, they allocate the cab to the customer, which is no rocket science. If you can provide a platform for customers to see taxis in and around them and provide a channel for them to interact with the drivers, they themselves can do it, which is no rocket science, right? And instead of doing it only for one taxi operator, if you can do it across all the taxi operators in the city, the probability of finding the taxi with us will be higher than any individual taxi. So that's how we started the internet. Right? So once we got this idea, we did an online survey. Right? So we got a bunch of people face the same issue. Then we went to the airport, spoke to people in and coming in and getting out of the airport. They also more or less segment the same thing. Then by that time we thought profit might be very skewed towards the frequent flights. Then we hired a bunch of people, asked them to stand in front of malls, speak to the people there, and everyone said that, oh, this is a pain that they're facing. The biggest problem that we encountered was people were not sure of getting a taxi after they had done from booking also. That's the challenge we took it head on. We named the company Taxi for Sure. Once we confirm a booking, we do whatever is possible from our end just to ensure that the customer would get a Taxi for Sure. That's how the entire Taxi for Sure journey started. We never looked at asset heavy, asset light, profitability, scalability, replicability, all those thoughts started flowing later. So we figured out there was a customer pain point, which is something that we were experiencing, and we thought we have a solution in mind, and we just wanted to go ahead and implement the solution and see how it really happens. But before we quit our cushy jobs, we did a significant amount of groundwork before we put in our papers.
Now, when you started off, that you've done your research on the customer side, but what about on the taxi side? Because convincing a taxi operator to come and tie up with a technology which, you know, most of them at that point would be like, you know, why do I need a phone? Why would I mean, obviously cell phone, but why would I need an app? How am I going to use it? Because before that kind of technology was in the market, how did you convince your first set of taxi drivers or operators to sign up with you?
So interesting question. So this we actually started after we had quit. Because we had a pain point and we thought we had a solution. And so essentially, personally, the way Appu, my partner, Appu and I think is we don't deliberate too much on making the right decision. What we do is we make a decision and then work towards making it right. I think we save a lot of time doing that, right? So frankly speaking, in the last 3 years of running Taxi for Sure, I've made more number of wrong decisions than the right decisions. But the impact of those fewer right decisions is so high that that all the impact of the wrong decision is such negative, right? But if we are deliberate too much on making those decisions, probably I don't think so. I would be sitting there, or probably would be here listening, right? So that's what. So when we started doing the research on the operator side, what we realized was 93% of this market is completely unorganized taxi operators, and 4% is the radio cab guys, the Meru, Easy Cabs, Mega Cabs. Those are only 4%. The remaining 3% is the car rentals. ABS car club, 6, budget car, Europe car camps. So we went up to the 93%, which is the unorganized guys. And we were shocked to see the kind of learnings that we had. These unorganized taxi operators were phenomenal when it came to the vehicle. They knew which banks use what kind of loans, what kind of permits to be obtained, where to obtain, how to obtain it, when to service the vehicle, which component of the vehicle has to be replaced by a original component only, which component can be replaced by the local make. They were phenomenal at that. We didn't know so much about our own car than what the operators knew about the cars, right? And the second thing is, they are very good at getting drivers and managing those cars. They buy a new car, get a driver from the village, train him and put him there. They knew how to speak softly to a soft driver, how to get aggressive with the road driver. They knew how to manage. What they were not comfortable with was technology. There were so many technology solutions that were available in the market, and everything was expensive. They didn't know, should they look at short term, they look at long term. They go with GPS one, non-GPS one, they didn't know how to go about doing it, right? The second bit was on the customer acquisition. There were three ways they knew how to acquire customers. They do newspaper insertion in the local neighborhood, the no parking boards, on the trees, on the electric poles, on the telephone lines, right? Put up the number, right? That's one. The second way was to pay some 15-20 lakh rupees upfront to JustDial and wait for JustDial to give them leads. And once they get a lead from JustDial, compete with 6 or 7 other taxi operators to convert that lead into a customer, right? Or work with a corporate, work on a 90 to 120 day credit cycle, and possibly gift the local admin guy Diwali gifts, Dasara gifts, Yugadi gifts, Pongal gifts to get your own money back, right? That's the market that they were operating. So we went to these guys and told them, guys, why don't you focus on what you know best, which is on the vehicle side and the driver side. We'll focus on what we know best. We'll work on technology, we'll work on the customer acquisition. We'll build a website, we'll do SEO, SEM, we'll build a brand, we'll drive repeats, we'll drive loyalty, we'll work with the Make Matter Clear Trip across the world. We'll work with Thomas Cook, Thomson Kings, Amadeus Galileo. We'll work with the corporate. The way we will work with the corporate is we'll integrate in their intranet. Right? And we'll be not be working with the local admin fellow, we'll be working with the head of HR. Right? So you don't have to really do that. And you don't have to pay us anything upfront. So we will give you a customer, not a lead, unlike this time. Right? This is the customer phone number. You pick them at so-and-so place, at this app, drop them at this place, and collect so much money. Once the customer has paid you, pay 10% of the money to us. So there is no upfront cost, no local marketing, nothing. Right? Another additional benefit is the utilization of the cars. A local operator, a driver who is working with the local operator, wakes up in the morning, cleans the car, and gets to the local operator. Let's say, the OMR area, right? He gets a customer in OMR area, the operator, right? The cab goes empty, picks up the guy from the OMR area, drops him at the airport. Since this guy hasn't done any marketing at the airport, he doesn't get any business there, right? So because of it, the cab comes back empty. So then someone from IIT Madras calls, he goes, drops them at the Chennai Central Station, no customers there, comes back empty. So typically, a cab used to drive for around 200 kilometers in a day, and used to have customers only for 70 to 80 kilometers. At once we came on board, the way we work, right, the cab continues to run for 200 kilometers, but has customers for 150 to 160 kilometers. So for the same expenses, the revenue per cab has doubled, right? How does this revenue translate into? This revenue translates into a color TV, a refrigerator, a washing machine at the driver's house. And this house of the driver is amidst the houses of other drivers. Right? Their wife, their kids put pressure on the driver, looking at their friends having a color TV at their place. So that then the driver wants to approach us and wants to be part of the network. Once the more number of drivers be part of the network, the probability of finding a taxi with us increases. This is the value proposition that we have on the customer side. Right? Because there is a higher probability of finding the taxi with us, the customers who are coming to us, they keep coming back to us, they repeat more often, and they start referring us to their family. So that becomes a complete cycle. So availability of these taxis at the customer end, and the operator, you focus on what you know best, we focus on what we know best, are the driver and significant increase in utilization. That's the reason we exist.
Interesting. So, once we finish, so now you've got the backend fully in place, and I think you've given the taxi operators a very attractive proposition. So when you started off, talk about 2011, you started off, I think, with an initial seed lakh capital of a couple of lakhs. How did you scale from there? In the sense, you know, how did there was a word of mouth marketing get your clientele, and over and above that, you have to develop the technology, you have to pay for that. So how did you, you know, you obviously bootstrap yourself, so how did you scale from zero to, let's say, a year from there?
Okay, very interesting question. So we got the idea in August 2010. We quit our jobs in December 2010, and we launched the portal in June 11. So the first 2-3 months after we got the idea, we were doing the market research, which I talked about. After that, we were waiting for a technology, because both of us were MBAs, right? And it was sometime since we so the last time I'd coded was in 2005. At post that, I'd not even code test any programming language. So for 3-4 months, we waited for some tech guy to join, tech guy to join, tech guy to join. No one joined. And eventually, we cracked and I started learning Python and started doing the first piece of coding. Right? So that's how it started. Right? So some part-time works and stuff like that. So we waited for some expert to come, and since there were no experts available, so we had to get our answer and we did that. As far as the customers are concerned, so this was very interesting then. We were so naive then, right? So we put a lot of effort in getting that 60-60-10-10 number, right? So right? And we built the website also, doing a few puttings, so few night outs, we built the website. And after that, what happened was, so the website went live. We had got the phone number. So we had a round table. So we used to work in 100 square feet top floor. That is, there was a lift room. So we used to sit in the lift room and we used to work. Right? There was a round table, we put the phone on the round table. So we made the website go there, but both Aprama and I sat across the table with the phone in between. And the phone didn't ring. We thought that the phone is going to automatically ring. It didn't ring. So then after the week, we realized that the phone is not going to ring this way. So we need to do something else. So then after that, so till then we had not met our friends. Right? So then we started meeting our friends and told them that, okay, you work with Yahoo, you work with Wipro, you have an intranet. Right? Why don't you tell them that there is something called taxi portion this day? Right, we gave them the draft of the email also, because not many people want to write, post it on a company intranet or write on their own. So we wrote the draft, so okay, why don't we put, copy this and paste it and stuff like that. Right, whenever, so we used to call friends early in the morning or day time in the morning. So why do you want to take your car and go to office today? Why don't you book taxi with us? So we did all that, right? So we started on June 5th, mid-July, is when we got our first unknown customer. Everyone else was this 8 a.m. in the morning call and tell them that 9 a.m. will send you a cab taxi, but why don't you take it? Right, that's how we said. So there was this girl, Pallavi, she had booked a cab at 3 a.m. in the morning from Kormanta in Bangalore to the airport. Right, so we got exact, so excited that was done. So she was working with Yahoo. One of her friends in Yahoo had put it up on the internet and she saw that and she had booked it with us. So we want to go see how is the experience of the customer. But it was pretty late, right? And I look like this. My partner is taller and broader than me. Right? At 1 a.m. in the morning, right? We don't really come across those days who are friendly and who are running a company and stuff like that. So even then, we went and stood in front of the house at 1 a.m. in the morning. Right? Just to ensure that the can will come. I mean, that's the excitement because we put in so much. So July, right? There was nearly close to 1 year of effort. Right, and we saw that something is happening and stuff like that, we went. And so then after some time we realized that if both of us are standing in front of the house like this, people will misunderstand. So we went outside and we were standing in the dark and things like that. And we saw two girls coming. Right? And what they did was they jumped the compound. Then we thought that should we even approach them or should we run away from them? What if their parents see two guys, two girls? Right? People will misunderstand. But that's essentially how it started. And things started picking up. Post that thing. So, liked the concept of be essential personally seeing out because we gave her visiting class and things like that, right? After that, I think she went and checked her LinkedIn profile, Facebook profile and stuff like that. She thought that, okay, we're not feeling the goons as thought it would be and things like that. So she started, she put it up on our blog and things like that, and due to which some of the people picked it up. Then we realized that, oh, if you put up a blog, people would read, right? So, I mean, we were so busy with whatever that we used to do. and we didn't really realize that things have changed on that bit, right? So then we went pretty aggressively on those people. So we went to alumni events. I don't know how many people attend alumni events. We never attended alumni events. All of a sudden, our alma mater made a lot more sense. We went there, we started taking some initiative so that we can get some space on the website, right? On the KRC, NITK Suratkar website, on the IIM, on the alumni network as well. So we started doing that, and slowly, slowly, people started referring us. So somewhere in November is when we realized that there is something called Google AdWords, and that essentially makes or breaks the business. Then we started putting some money. And the timing was right, so we just started the November 14th or 15th is when we started Google AdWords, and we met the Axel guys on the 29th. Right, Axel Pandas guys on the 29th. So we were doing around 5 to 10 trips per day till then, and all of a sudden we moved to the 30 to 40 trips per day. So that started exciting. So they were asking us questions on how did you manage from 5 to 10 trips in the last 5 months, and all of a sudden to triple that number for it. Right, so that's when things started.
So the initial team that you set up was only you and your partner. But as you grew for the first year, year and a half, how many people did you have? How did you, you know, select those people? Was your initial startup as a good person?
Interesting. So, how many of you are close to 30 here in this room?
Okay. Most of us will be.
Okay. You guys are a big problem. So when Appu and I, we were 29 when we started 3 years back, right? Because we were MBAs, when we approached our friends who continued in the tech stream, right? So we went and, why don't you become our co-founder? So join a startup, we do that. They said, I'm completely into that. I want to be part of the startup and stuff like that. But I have a housing loan of 60,000 rupees per month. People are married. The next logical step that they do is to buy a house. And once they are in that housing loan thing, they just can't, you can't pay someone that kind of the money. Right? So I don't know why we didn't invest, my parents into the banking system, buying a house and stuff like that. But so all of our friends, almost all of them, half of them were in US, and whoever were left in India, all of them had housing loans. Right? That was a major deal breaker, right? So then we asked them, okay, what about your friends, your colleagues and stuff like that? They were also housing loans. Okay. Now one level below. What do they have? Younger sisters, younger brothers. No, seriously, I mean, you have to do something. At least they will not have a housing loan. Right? The housing loan is something that killed us initially. So we were so frustrated, because we couldn't make any progress. Everyone that we met, everyone had a housing loan. Right? I don't know why the real estate prices in Bangalore were so high. So we went with their younger siblings. So those people, I can't force my brother or sister to join a startup. I'll introduce you to you. You go, right? So we go talk to them and stuff like that. They completely interesting, very interesting. I'll start the starter, but we'll never quit the job. And then we went with their friends and stuff like that, but didn't really make much progress. But over a period of time, so since we started in Python Django, so there was something called Django India site. I don't know how many people know Django here. There's a Django India site. So that was the. So you didn't ask me the question about how did we fund our the initial few days, right? So how many of you are married here? And your spouses are working? Spouses are working or not?
Yes.
Beautiful. Lucky guys. So. So either you need to have a rich father-in-law, or you need to have a working spouse.
Very good.
Right? So when Appu and I had married my batchmate from Suratkar. So Appu and I are also from Suratkar. So my wife, when Appu and I told her the idea, she told, okay, I'll give you 2 years, do whatever you want, whatever time pass that you guys, this is the word she used. Otherwise, after 2 years, if you're not going anywhere, which I think is the high probability, then you have to get back to your job. So we said, fine. So then she said that, okay, if I'm going to be in India, things are not going to happen, so you need money. So what I will do is, I'll go abroad, I'll work in $1,000,000 so that I can fund. So she was essentially the first investor in the company. So she went to Singapore. Right? So on and off, I used to visit her. So one such day, I was at the Bangalore airport, right? The flight got delayed by an hour. So I didn't have anything else to do. I just opened up the laptop and I saw the Django India website. Then I saw a whole list of names, right? So I spent some time to create a template, right, which has no mention of the name and things like that. Created that and sent it to all the people. By the time I landed in Singapore, there were three people who responded. I had sent it to some 44 people. There are three people who had responded. Then I called them from Singapore, and I liked two of them. And like when I came back to Bangalore, I met up with them and convinced one guy to essentially work in 100 square feet office. And that guy is Ashok Ravi. Other guy is still with us. He's our first person. Good. So that and the first employee plays a significant role in establishing the culture of the company, right? So culture is something that everyone talks, but when you are starting a company, right, you just don't know. As long as it was only Appu and me, we were friends, right? The way we used to talk when we were 18, 19, we used to talk the same way when we were 29 also, right? Nothing much really changes. But when you get your first person, right, the things change, right? You just can't have the same communication that you are having with someone whom you know for like 14 years. And have a similar kind of a conversation with them. The first person plays a significant role. The person came on board, he understood what we are doing, he did everything else apart from coding. The tech guy, right? So we used to have a race that who reaches the office first. As soon as, so 8 a.m. I used to reach, then it becomes 7:30 a.m. The prize of reaching the office first was they have to sweep the floor. Right, and that way is to compete, right? And when we went to VC interactions, both Appu and I used to go. Then someone had to take the calls, right? And there was this tech guy who was supposed to go. He used to sit and take calls, poor thing. So that also really helped because he understood what the customers were asking, and he understood whenever he used to call up the follow up the drivers and stuff. And he understood what the drivers' issues were. So it really helped. And that's essentially how we went. And and the first call center person we had was the second employee, right, Guru. So the way he came was, he came in a bike with studded earrings, right, and flunked 3 years before, right, and he came. And I asked him, okay, do you have a CV? So I thought, yes, and he took it out from here, right, eightfolded CV, and he also like open to find. So. Wait, can you take calls? Yeah, I can take calls. Fine. Sorry. This guy, the guy is still there. And I think that guy is the one grew immensely in the company. So he started as a call taker. 3 months later, he became moved to dispatch. After that, he moved into supply. And since he knew Tamil, when we started China operations, he was the head of supply. That guy is 21 years old. He hasn't even finished graduation. He's the manager in the company. 3 years, 2.5 years back, he joined 6 months later. 2.5 years back, with two studded earrings, with the eightfold thing, he was completely different. Now, once he started working, right? So that sets the things apart, right? A guy like him could become a manager. He hasn't even finished graduation. He's 21. Hasn't finished graduation. And he essentially manages a team of around 12 people now in Bangalore. Right? That's essentially. And those are the people who essentially defined the culture of the company. But it was a struggle. And after that, when these people came, right? Our references. And we closing a funding round also helped. So people started getting about us, and we had money to pay as well. So things started picking up from there on.
So that brings me to the next question. Your very first round of funding. So you go on the other side. So your first angel round that came from Bloom and Axel and all that. So how did you convince? Because you were saying that you know you've gone from 5 to 10 rides a day to maybe 30, 40. So that's a pretty early days. So how did you convince them that you know we are the guys, back us, we would do something spectacular?
I was a consultant. Actually, that's not really the answer. We never approached them with a sense of funding because both Axel and Ilyan had never funded any company so early in their lives, right? So it was more of relationship building. Right, so you just know that we exist. If someone else comes with a similar kind of application and stuff like that you know that you reach out to us. And that's, I tell you, is very, very important. Even though it doesn't really make sense to raise the money then, but you have to talk to the investors, right? So that they know that they have to know that you exist. It's very, very important. So if they get to know about some other company who's pitching to them, then at least what they will do is at least they'll reach out to us. If they don't know that you exist and you're working in a silo and stuff like that, it becomes very, very difficult. So I think that was the time even Ola was raising a round of funding, right? And that's another company called Get Me Captain. So all three of us were together, right? And interesting. So we never positioned ourselves that we need to invest in this and stuff. That we were just sharing our story, right? Why we started Taxi for sure. What is the kind of market that we are looking at? How do we want to go about doing it? And how we are essentially scaling to that kind of level? I think we were the least of the other two people. All of us ahead of us. Ola started one year ahead of us. Right, and Get Me Cab also had started much before us, right? And we were the juniors, right? So there were a few tags there, right? So one of those meetings, so we had met the two partners of Axel. So we were supposed to meet the third partner of Axel. So we went into the room, right? So there was this associate who did the maximum amount of research about the company and stuff like that. So they were discussing. So they asked, how do you manage your bookings? We opened up the Google spreadsheet and we showed it to them, right? This is how we are managing. So there are those two people were like, hey, A2P, Google spreadsheet use correct. Those two are also using Google spreadsheet. And like, okay, we had that. We're like waiting. So that day, the third partner meeting didn't happen. Right? This was around 5 p.m. in the evening. So they asked us to come at 11 a.m. in the morning next day. So that night, we essentially transformed the entire Google spreadsheet into a system. Right. So next morning when we went and spoke to them, the partners, how do you manage the bookings? We told, open up the system and we told, oh, you guys are using the system. Google spreadsheet is completely inflexible. Right. Whatever the comments that the associates had made yesterday, the previous day, right? So we essentially said the same thing. So and the VC asked, okay, can you make certain changes to the product? Right? Which made sense. Which means, so can you essentially do that? Can you use some color coding so that you know that these are high priority ones, these are low priority ones, so these are the bookings in the next one, so that we don't miss out on that. So it made changes. So this happened on a Friday, Monday when we had made all those changes. Right? Then the VC realized that, okay, UX seems to have a great grip on technology and stuff like that. So there, on the technology front, we got a higher score compared to the other people. Right, then it all depends on the market size and how many people are scaled and stuff like that. And typically at the stage, I don't think so. Even the VC understands who to bet on. Right, so essentially they bet on the team. They bet on the team and some of the traction that they will see. Right, no one essentially agrees to invest in a company in the first interaction itself. They typically take those 2-3 months and they see the traction from the first time they met. And 2 months, 3 months down the line, what they see, what has been the progress, and what is the kind of inputs that they have given, and what are the things that these people have done. Right? If people have done everything the investor would have said, that is again a red flag. That means that the founders are not really thinking. If you haven't done anything that they've asked, that means that the founders are not really open. So they come with this fixed reference. So if I invest, I will just lose my money because they will not listen. I will not be able to use my experience. Right? If they do everything that they say, then that is also a sign. So there is a thin line that people have to really work on. Right? Then it becomes a lot more simple. And the way the investing thing really happened was also, we went there, asked us to make a project, come up with the market sizing and stuff like that. We went to discuss the market sizing. We opened up the slide, we told, okay, don't open up the slide, we have few things. And they gave the term sheet. And we didn't understand what a term sheet was. Right, and term sheet is a state that they give that, okay, this is the valuation of the company, we are putting so much of money, right, and this is the state that we are going to take and things like that. We didn't really understand, we didn't know how to react also. Because we had approached them to raise 50 lakhs, and what they were offering us was 5 crores. And because we want 50 lakhs, we don't need 5 crores. They told, see, the thing is, we don't invest in a company this small. Right, but the minimum that we can invest is 500k, right? And both Axel and Alien wants to invest in your company. Right? 500k, 500k, 5 crores. You guys are not really worth whatever the valuation that we are giving. Even you know that, we know that. But just because it's the minimum that we can do, we don't have a choice, but we need to take it to that. And that's how things really started. Right? And that was the first, we were the first exception. And we didn't know that till that happened. But we didn't really stop going to them just because Alien doesn't invest in a company which is like 6 months old. Axel doesn't invest in a company which is like 6 months old. But we started approaching them and we did that. And how did we reach out to them? One night, Aparamaya started because he didn't get sleep. So the way we used to manage the call center was, Aparamaya used to be, because we didn't have people, Aparamaya used to be up till 3 a.m. in the morning to take the call. So we had something called call handling. There is a series of 10 phones. If you switch off the first three phones, the fourth phone will ring. If you switch off the fourth phone, the fifth phone will ring, right? So, after I had one phone at home, I had one phone at home. 3 a.m., I used to switch off and sleep. I used to wake up at 3 a.m. and take those calls. Right? So, one night, so there were no calls, it was up. So, we started Googling about all the angel investors, all the VCs and stuff like that. We had created a template, we started sending it to all the people in the network. And that some of the Axel, the young guys, responded to it a month later. Right, and that's essentially how we went about doing it.
And that probably gave you a huge leg up in terms of being able to scale from being a garage operation to, you know, setting up an office, setting up a bigger team and all that. So how did you get from there to possibly your next round of funding?
Okay, so this is a bit weird. I don't know how many people will understand and relate to it. I think that was the night when we got a commission, that was the night I got depressed. So I don't know. It's a very, very strange feeling. Apparently, because, see, till then, starting a company was just a dream. Right? Raising funds, we didn't know that we could do that and stuff like that. It's always we wanted to do that. But till then, it was fine. So we had only Ashok Ravi and Guru. Right? And till then, we always knew that if we start working, our previous companies will take us. That was not really a change at all. But once we got that kind of money, we knew that we are going to get people on board who are going to come just because of the story that we sell, or just because they were, I don't know, currently also we are around 540 people. I don't know how many of them are there because they understand the tax and social business, and how many of them are there just because of us. Right? And it's no longer a time pass. Right? It's a commitment that we have for the people. Because you raise a fund, that's the thing that is not, right? You know, you are responsible. Right? You have maximum responsibility that one needs to have is probably for the 4 or 5 people in the home. Right? And if you screw it up also, it's okay, someone in the home, either father would be there or brother, sister, someone would probably step up. But here, real fast founders, we mess up, that is the end of it. There is no backup, right? And we don't know how long would it take. That was the night we like, okay. That was the night we actually thought about, okay, what is that we want to do as part of Taxi for Sure? Because it's no longer a game, it's no longer fun, it's no longer two friends who are doing something, right, in a 100 square feet office space. Right? This is something that we are going to build, right, and that's how things really soon. And then we got very serious about what we want to do and what is that we want to do and what is the kind of commitment that we have, right. So that is the day we decide that if Taxi for Sure is going to exist, it is going to exist for its people. Right, so the guidelines that we follow in the company is we need to keep our employees happy. Happy employees ensure happy drivers. Happy drivers ensure happy customers. Happy customers ensures profitability. Profitability ensures further investments. Right, that was the night we decided that, so that was the night we slept at around 4 a.m. or 5 a.m. in the morning, because we were discussing this, what is that we have gotten ourselves into. And it's only about the commitment of the people. We don't typically put our consumers first, we always put our employees first. Because I don't take calls anymore. It's our people who take calls. I don't interact with the drivers anymore. It's our people who interact with the drivers. The kind of experience that drivers get when they interact with the company, that's the kind of experience that they deliver to the customers also. Right, and the way we treat our people, that's the way they would treat the drivers. And the way we treat the drivers, that's the way the drivers would treat the customers. And that's essentially how we went about it.
Now, when you're scaling up, you obviously had to keep innovating as you went along. So, you know, in your opinion, what role does innovation play, especially in your industry, and how important would it have been in terms of your success so far? Is
it
just doing something better or doing something different?
See, innovation is not restricted only to product.
Right.
So essentially with the idea that we had, it itself was an innovation. So there was no Uber then. When we did the market research, right, there was no Uber, there was nothing on the table. So it was an innovative idea by itself, right? And that's essentially what we wanted to do, right? And could we have started that from day one? No. Because the drivers, so the taxi business is a business, is something that people don't get into in India. Just because people haven't really got anything elsewhere, they start driving taxis. So they are not typically the educated, the literate guys. So they don't know how to interact with a smartphone or the technology, right? So we had to get them educated. We need to get them onto the same platform, right? That's how we did that. So some innovations really happened in the way we work, right? We work. So at least, so when we raised $1 million, the investors wanted to understand, are we the Apple AI, are we capable of building a business? So we were at around 50 trips per day. They told us, with this $1 million, can you get to 500 trips per day? Right? With that $1 million, we thought, okay, we'll do this. Right? We eventually got to 570 trips per day with that $1 million. But what we did, there was, because we wanted to get those transactions, we had a bunch of call takers, dispatchers, and there was no bid management. Right? So then we realized, when we raised the next round of funding, right, we wanted to open up Delhi. We opened up Delhi, there was no one who knew everything about the business who could essentially go to Delhi and set it up. Right? Then we thought, okay, we made a mistake. Right? So what is the easiest way to get people? Okay, there were people, Meru Camps, Maya Camps, Easy Camps, right? They guys understand the industry. Get them on board. Right? Which is the logical thing, right? But once we got those people on board. But one of the learning that we had was, initially whenever Appu or I got an idea, right? So we used to come to the office and share that idea, right? So then in order to get that idea implemented, so we used to motivate them, push them and stuff like that. Then we realized that this is not going to scale. So then we got that, okay, we got an idea because of the context that we had. Right? And we are not doing rocket science. Right? So whenever we get into a meeting, instead of proposing the idea, build the context. Someone in the room would come up with the same idea. And they feel that it is their idea. And then you don't have to worry about this. You don't have to really worry about motivation and pushing them and stuff like that. Right? Which is a logical thing. So that's essentially when we got people from the camp industry and stuff like that, right? That's essentially what we wanted to do. But another learning that we had was, these people were so confined by the market norms that they were not really able to push. So, for example, the percentage of calls that we were rejecting, telling that we don't have camps, was around 7%. We told these people that, see, we are in a customer service business, we just can't reject even a single booking. This Meru rejects 30%, Mega rejects 35%. We are just rejecting 7%, we are for the market, why do you want to work on it? But no, this is customer service. Even rejection is a part of the customer service. You need to do. They are not able to change. We are way above the market. No. So you can't build a context. If someone is so restricted with the market norms, if you build a context how to reduce the reject, they are not going there. Right? So then you realize that, okay, fine. This is the case, then probably we should not get people from the industry. Right? Rejects is one of the examples. There are multiple examples in the service. Writers behave this way only. You can't change them. Right? Then you can't really figure out how do you disrupt. You can't do a disrupt when you are confined with market norms, because disruption is all about changing the market norms. If you are confined with the market norms, you can't do it. Right? Then we decide that we'll not get people from the industry and we'll not get people who are confined by the market norms. Right? So what we did? We went and started hiring people directly from campuses. BNIMs, ISPs, IITs, and stuff like that, right? So those people came on board. They didn't know what the market norm was. We told them that we need to get there. Or they were like, they used to come up with different ideas of how to get there. Right? Which was also a logical thing, right? And we were very happy that we cracked this. The challenge that really came up later that was, these guys who were like fresh out of college were very bad people. They used to tell on the people's face that, hey, how dumb can you be? You are a stupid guy. This is not the way. I mean, you don't do that in a corporate setting, right? Okay, you do that in your group study and stuff like that, but not in a corporate life. And when you're interacting with people, right, there are people who take calls, there are people who dispatch, there are operators who are not educated. You can't tell an operator you are a dumb guy. You can't even understand this. This is Google Maps. You can't understand this, right? So it leads to a lot of people management issues, right? So now we're like, no, we are at the stage where now we get people who are not from the industry, but with some years of experience. And we don't know whether it is the right way or not. Next year, probably when I come here, probably I'll tell that, okay, that is also not going to work. Probably this is what we are doing. So to your point, right? Innovation is not just about the product and stuff like that. Innovation is the way, about how do you improvise. Right? You learn, in the company also, right, what to do is people have to make mistakes. If you're not making mistakes, you're not experimenting enough. But if you make the same mistake again, then we have a problem. Right? And that's essential. So you make mistakes, make an experiment. Somewhere or the other, something will click. And that click, something that has clicked also, right? As an experiment. Whatever that we were doing 2 years back, if we had done the same thing last year, it would have got us here. Whatever that we did last year, if we do the same thing this year, it will not get us wherever we want to be. So innovation is something that is constant. Be it whatever that we do as part of the policies, the way we run things, the products that we have, the priorities, the way we prioritize, the kind of people that we get on board, everything has to be improvised. Everything has to be improvised.
When you started off, you must have, after you tested initial success, you would have started looking at various metrics to make sure you're on the right track. You're skewing off track, on track, apart from just having, you know, things like call rate or, you know, number of cabs per day. So was there something that you know, concrete that you were looking at before your first investment and after the investors came? Because I think they were the same ones who came in subsequent rounds as well. So there's something they brought to the table as well. So.
A lot. So, before the investors came in, our entire focus was to make the phone ring. I mean, trust me, that's very, very difficult. Because we don't come from the marketing background, and we don't know how to reach out to our taxi customers and stuff like that, right? So, we had a website, we had everything, we had a financial plan, we had a business plan, everything in place, but we couldn't make the phone ring. So, initially, the bit was on the making the phone ring. So, once the investors came on board, essentially, the first round of investment, right, 50 to 500 transactions, that's essentially was scale. Scale became the entire focus because we had money to raise and we had access to marketing talent within those investors only who would help us how to make the phone ring. Right? That essentially became our side step. Right? So how do we start doing analytics? Right? That's essentially was the focus area. After that, the next round, so once they realized that these people are capable of building a business, right? Next set of priorities that we started chasing was to prove whether the model is scalable, through the business model actually, right? So on paper we told them that okay, you start aggregating all the taxis in the city, right? The demand is too high compared to the supply, and if you have access to all the supply, the you have to do a lot of service, a lot of bookings. Correct, right? So prove whether the model is scalable, right? Find that. The next thing is whether this is a model that works only for an IT-centric city like Bangalore, or it can be replicated elsewhere also. Right? We told every city in India has the same problem, it can be replicated. Right. The third thing is asset light. If the model is asset light, you're not spending so much of money, then you need to get to profitability a lot more sooner. Prove whether the model is profitable. Right. So then the chase was not on the numbers. The chase was essentially proving the business model. Right. Whether the model is replicable, whether the model is scalable and profitable. That's essentially what we went off. Right. So in terms of metrics, the metrics was evolved. So there were a bunch of leading metrics that we chose, there are a bunch of lagging metrics that we chose. Leading metrics is the number of calls and stuff like that. Lagging metrics are how many cab operators are still contributing to the system. Right? How many customers are repeating. Right? And that's, so we started looking at something called cohorts. How are the people behaving? Right? So there is a bunch of leading metrics, there are a bunch of lagging metrics. Right? When you're talking about profitability, the lagging metrics took precedence. When you're talking about scalability, it's a leading matrix. Right? Scaling matrix is okay, number of transactions that you are doing every day, day on day. Lagging matrix is okay, are the customers happy? Decay, the experience of service. Sorry, are the customers happy? How do you know they are happy? Did you take feedback? You took feedback. Right? They said good, great service. The next time they wanted a taxi, they went with Melu. Then you have a problem. Right? Then they will start looking at the lagging matrix. So, we essentially combined a bunch of leading metrics and the lagging metrics to get variable. So every time you raise a funding, right, to essentially share a dream, share a story, right? Okay, I'm going to use X amount of money to essentially get here. And why do we want to get here? This is why we want to get here, right? And how do we know that we are on the right track? These are the kind of metrics that we will track. So once we have that conceptual clarity, then the investor also gets that confidence that, okay, you guys know what you are doing. Then it's easy for them to really part with the money. Right? And that's also, and it also essentially helps us to percolate it downwards also. Right? So we are now 540 people. If we don't really have that kind of clarity, right, by the time it reaches, there is always be a Chinese whisper. The more levels comes, right, whatever that you want to intend to do, by the time the person is doing, it will be completely different. But if we don't have clarity on the top, person at the bottom will not have any clarity. Right, so essentially it was very, very important for us to have clarity. What are the things that we would chase? What are the metrics that we are going to monitor? And start monitoring those.
And when you started off with your product, you're talking about more than the tech level. So when you started off your app, your website and all that, how did you know which were the key areas to focus on? You know, is it going to be ease of use? Is it going to be, you know, location based on the app, for example? Were you able to test it out with some users? Did you evolve it? Or did you guys see and brainstorm, figure it out, and then evolve that separately over time based on actual user feedback, not even feedback?
So here the way we approached was, okay, as I put in the beginning, right, we didn't spend too much of time in making the right product. We built the MVP and we rolled out the MVP and just waited for customers to react. And customers came up with some nasty comments, friends, investors, everyone came up with nasty comments. Then we started looking a lot more seriously about the product. But what is it? If the MVP is out, at least people will understand what is that we are trying to do. So that was much, much more important. Right? And then, so asking a bunch of, so let's say if I start asking them, okay, how to build something, right? Everyone has a point of view, right? It's very difficult. So how do you essentially segregate the signal from the noise? That's very, very important, right? So you get into that intellectualization exercise. So in order to avoid that, what we did was we did an MVP, asked people to book taxis and stuff, and then asked them, okay, we are going to have a focus group discussion, right, in this so-and-so hotel, but if you have to come, you need to come with a taxi for short cap, and that should be booked through the app only. Right? Then whoever is going to come for that FTD, they exactly knew what was the problem. Right? Then yeah, so there are picked and nasty comments, but they were all signals. Because that user didn't come. It was not an intellectual. So if you do this, would it be fine? They would say, that could be fine, but can you increase the font size? No. Now they were like, forget the font size, forget the design. This is not working, it's crashing. Right, fix that. Right, so then that's so we started getting the very, very relevant feedback.
Okay. I have two part questions. So today you have people like Uber who enter the market, huge muscle, huge brand. How are you competing with a Uber? Okay, Ola, Meru, you already, you know, had heads with them. So how are you competing with a global brand in Uber? And secondly, maybe a little more difficult question would be, why did you go for another fundraiser? You did around $10 million in May. And another
$30 million
yesterday. So why
within
such short
time? Well, very relevant question. Okay, on the Uber story, right? Uber angle, I don't know how it would really pan out. So we have some advantages in the business that they don't. We understand the India market. Right? They don't. So trying to do something that has worked in US and trying to replicate it here would be a significant challenge. Right, so I can go into the differences and stuff like that, but I think that's not a relevant thing. Right, the question that we need to ask is, Amazon, outside the US, where are they successful? They are wiped out of China. They haven't made any inroads anywhere. Right, but they are the next big thing to Flipkart in India. How? We don't know. Why are they even pitted against Flipkart? We don't know. Right, the second thing is Uber. Outside of US, where are they successful? Right, they entered late in India, but over the last few years, right, they are currently in 50 countries, around 130 cities or something. Outside of US, where are they successful? Right, that's a more relevant question. So before you start taking a competition seriously, we are working in OPEC, we understand what are the numbers that they're going, what are the strategies and stuff like that. But should we start losing sleep over it? Not necessarily. And we need to really understand, right? So, and competition is good. Competition is healthy because the entire industry depends. Right? It took Flipkart a whole lot of time to convert people from crossword landmark to them. Right? It would have been very, very expensive for us to convert a phone customer to book taxis using an app. So once they move to an app, moving from one app to another app is a lot more cheaper exercise. Moving a customer from a phone to an app is a lot more costly exercise. Instead of we spending all the money and converting them, if Uber also with that 1.2 billion raise, if they also put in some money to do that, that would be great. And then we feel that we will have access to a larger fleet, right? And we understand the Indian operations better. then you'll be able to provide very great services to the customers. Right? That's memorable. The next question, which is which is a difficult question. Right? So why we raised 1 million and why we raised 1 million? So there is a generic answer. One is if someone is giving money, take it. Right? why say no to the money, right? So that's a generic answer. But having said that, why we agree to really do that is the competition is heating up, right? Immensely heating up, right? So we are, if you have noticed, right, Taxi for Sure is not in Mumbai yet, right? Which is the biggest taxi market. And in Bangalore, Ola, Uber, Taxi for Sure, all of us are there coexisting. Right. If anyone of you wants to start a tax segregation in Bangalore, you will get wherever we are at in the next 1 or 2 years only. Because the market is that big and we haven't even made so much impact. But when you're looking at tier 2, tier 3 cities, there could be 1 or 2 aggregators max. There's a significant first more advantage there. The tier 1 cities, not necessarily. Tier 2, tier 3, there's a significant first more advantage. Right, I mean, the way is when you're essentially competing against someone who wants to have a checklist. Right, I need to be in X number of cities, in Y number of countries, and stuff like that. Right, you don't have a choice but to be there so that you don't want to lose out. Right, the people that we're talking about are the uneducated, illiterate taxi operators and the drivers. Right, once they get hooked onto a particular technology, it's very, very challenging to change them from one technology to another. Then you don't have a choice. You need to hit that. So we need to run to stay at the same place. Right? And if you really want to make some inroads somewhere, we need to run faster than what we had planned to run before. And if we have to run faster, we will consume a lot more resources. Right? And that's where the resources really come in.
Thanks for the candid answer. So my probably last question on the business front would be, you and your partners knew each other for years, and then you decided to set up your friends before you became business partners. How important is it to have a co-founder? And you know, do you think that both of you coming together is what made this success? Would you, do you think if you'd done it with anybody else, you would independently done something else, would have been as successful? Or is it the combination that is important?
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's more individual person. Like, as I told earlier, right, I was more of a team player. So here also it's more of a team, and typically it gets very, very lonely when you are running a startup, right? So because even though there is a significant amount of pressure that one is going through, right, you just can't show that in front of the people who are working, right? So let's say you are on a funding cycle and you haven't been able to, it's been 2 months and you haven't been able to get a term sheet, you are under the pressure, you show that to your people, right? They feel that, okay, the company is not able to raise funds. And if they start leaving, then instead of helping yourself, the problem becomes too compounded, right? And you need to always have someone you can essentially bank on, right? A shoulder to hang on and stuff like that. Right? It's better instead of one person carrying the entire load, right? If you have someone to fall back on and probably carry the same load, someone who can with whom you can have candid conversation, understand or use someone as a sounding board, it really, really helps, right? And I think two or three people max, I think that would be a great combination, right? But if someone is very, very deterministic and someone can think deeper, that is also possible. But I personally feel that you need to really have a co-founder who can probably do that, because it becomes too demanding and it becomes too demanding in the mind. There are lots of sleepless nights, right? I don't know how many people have, I know the phenomenon of creative stress. How many people understand creative stress? Right? I mean, people go through stress because of the amount of work to be done. But you actually know how to get the work done. But it's only the amount of work and the time that is required. But creative stress is a stress where you don't have time and you need to achieve something and you have no idea how to go about doing it. Right? If you do a night load also, you can't get it done because you don't know how to go about doing it. And the more you lose sleep, the more difficult it becomes to essentially becomes that quicksand kind of a phenomenon. And those are times you need someone who understands the same thing, someone who has the who shares the same dream, someone who has the same amount of commitment and the same amount of passion to fall back on. Right? Otherwise, it becomes too spiraling. Too spiraling, and it becomes a quicksand kind of thing.
So I sort of ending with the business part, a couple of general questions. So,
it's on. Well, I'll give an example. So, one of the first set of people, right? So, we wanted to do a reference check with this person's boss, right? I called him at around 10 in the night, right? That reference check usually takes 5 minutes, 10 minutes max, right? It doesn't take more than that, right? This reference check, so he started asking what is that you guys are doing and stuff like that, right? A 10 minute call became 1.5 hour call, right? At 10 p.m. in the night, started, got over 11 p.m. So I was very candid, it was very in the very, very initial days.
Right.
6 a.m. in the morning, he called me and told that, okay, I'm interested in joining. Right. So we wanted a guy who is like a level below, but his boss only is interested. Right? What more you want? Right? And initially also, so we were speaking to the investors, that we used to think that okay, this is easily doable. So if we start doing that, they would know probably a bunch of great guys who would do this. If we share this idea, what you could do it. Right? So people, so the VCs are those guys who are very, very, I think they've got a PhD in diplomatic conversations, they would never say no on your face. Brilliant idea, you guys are awesome. Show me traction. Show me traction, show me traction, show me traction. They will never tell that, okay, you guys start to make some progress, you're not doing anything. Right? And they will know, not nearly, they never say no on your face directly. Right? So then when you start, if you don't share your ideas and stuff like that, right, it doesn't go anywhere. Right? You would not really get input, you would not really do anything. Right? So always talk, whoever that you meet, right? Right? Shamelessly talk to people. They talk about that, whether they understand, they don't understand, it doesn't really matter. But people who don't understand, at least they'll pick up something, they'll go talk to their friends who would actually understand. Right? And then those people want to, okay, put me in touch with these guys, I want to talk to them. Right? And that's how things start really, really picking up. Right? And that's our first tie-up, Alchemist Camp tie-up, Mega Camps also happened that way. We were generally talking to someone at a pub. Right, so the guy was not interested in listening, but because we are buying him his beer, so he was listening to us. Right, so conversation happened and stuff like that. So then someone called him and he told that, okay, with a bunch of guys who are essentially telling me about everything about the taxi market. And that guy happened to be the brother-in-law of Mega Cabs CEO. So then that guy put us in touch with Mega Cabs, and that was the first deal that really happened. So share, right? You share it, you sell it. You hold it, you don't have a choice but to keep it to yourself. Right? That, I think that's essentially primarily. And you'll get a lot of people, not just the funding bit, but you'll get a great bunch of people also to get on board. Because people have some ideas on their own and they would think that can I do this alone and stuff like that. If they see a bunch of people who are also working on the similar lines, right, they would come and join them. Right? You would get talent, you would get money, and you would also get some contacts also. Relevant context for the industry that would really open up. And I think that would necessarily be the key.
Do you have any business icon that you look up? Is there anybody who's an inspiration to you?
There is no single individual, right? There are multiple people actually. So one is obviously Steve Jobs in terms of we are disrupting the industry. Right, a disruption in industry doesn't really come from talking to people who are confined to the industry. Right? You go ask customers that what is that you want to be improved in a taxi booking. No, I don't think anyone would suggest an app. I need an app-based booking. Right, a disruption. So that is Steve Jobs' one. Right, in terms of going through tough times. Right, Ben Horowitz. Right, the Anderson Horowitz. I don't know. So there is this book called Hard Thing About Hard Things, right, by Ben Horowitz. I think whoever is serious about becoming an entrepreneur, right, I think it's a textbook. It's a mandatory reading, The Hard Thing About Hard Things by Horowitz, right. And when it comes to scaling business, right, and managing your time and your work life and family life also, which is also very, very important. I understand that a few of your spouses, right, you just can't leave off the spouse all the time. So you need to really do something also. So there, Andre Grove, Intel, right? That guy essentially figured out, he took Intel from a microprocessor to whatever the industry that they are in currently, right? So my friend Paul from a memory to a microprocessor industry. So Andrew Brule talks about how to essentially manage scale, right? Jobs, figuring out creativity, that when so many people are saying something else, have a completely different line of thinking and pursue that line of thinking. Don't let anyone bring you down, right? Or which whatever that comes, I would still struggle because I believe in this, irrespective of whatever it is, right? And Brule all about talking about how do we essentially pursue the most elusive work-life balance and achieve it also. I think that's something that we need.
And my last question to you would be, any advice apart from all the fantastic advice you've given us, any advice to would be and current partners?
See, what I believe in is, I think what we need to be is a bunch of dream chasers. Right, we need to dream, and chase that dream happen. Right, and the biggest limitation that we set by that we have is ourselves. If we don't dream a big enough dream, we are only setting the limitations. Right, no one understands the business as much as you guys do, as entrepreneurs. And if your dreams are limited, right, whatever the company would really achieve would also be limited. However impossible the things are, right? How, if you don't have any clarity on how to get there also, it doesn't really matter. But dream big, dream big, dream big, right? And that has been our personal learning also in the last 6 to 7 months. Because we went with the conventional way of building the business. Okay, first round you raised the $1 million, the next round would be, okay, your valuation was X, currently now we can look at a 4X to 5X valuation. This is the money that you can get. If you can't get this kind of money, then this is the kind of thing what you can achieve with that money. Then the third, next round of funding, okay, again, same man. That is not going to really help at all, right? You figure out that what is that you want to do and get money for. Alright? You figure out what is that you want to achieve and get people for that. Right? If you have a great dream, people will get excited and inspired by that dream. And if you don't really have that kind of a big dream, it's very, very difficult to get this kind of people. Right? You don't have to know how to do it, how to get there. You just have to have that kind of a dream. And this dream evolves. This dream evolves. So, for example, right? So initially when we started, we wanted to get all the taxi operators, at least the majority of the taxi operators on the network, where if you have just a higher probability than any individual taxi operator, which is good, right? So that was the first year dream, right? The second year dream was, okay, any yellow board vehicle in the city should be on the taxi portion platform, which is a big dream, right? Currently, any four-wheeler that gets manufactured should be on the taxi portion. Because why should anyone own cars? If you are never too far away from a taxi bus or cab, why should you even own a cab? Why should you own a car? Right? Or going to home to office, you have a car, cab, which turns out to be a lot more economical than purchasing a car, spending parking, venturing into the traffic and stuff like that. Now, so the dream evolves, but you know, one has to start dreaming big. The bigger the dream, a lot of people get excited. And it's always, and that everyone wants his story to relate, right? And that's essentially what really matters. See, this is something that we learned in mythology, right? You make Ravana, the all-powerful 10-head with a brother who is like a giant brother and stuff like that. You show that Ravana is that big, right? And Rama goes and kills Ravana. By virtue of it, she becomes bigger than Ravana. So everyone wants that. So everyone gets excited that this guy that goes down, and that everyone wants a story, and everyone latches onto the story, and that story has to be big, and it doesn't have to be big on day one. It has to be big, and it has to get bigger and bigger and bigger. And all the people who are there, because they're seeing future, only a okay, say what will happen to me in the future. No one is going to ask questions because things are getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Right. And things people just relate to that, and everyone wants to be part of the story, and that's essentially what we do. So we are writing a epic called Taxi for Sure. You have a choice to have a mention in that epic, or a line in the epic, or a paragraph in the epic, or a chapter in the epic, or you can write a sequel. And then the people have a choice. What is that they want? And everyone wants to relate to that. And that's essentially what it really means.
Wow. Okay, that's really good advice. So, it's a very general question. I'm just going to open the floor up to questions.
I have two questions on the same mind. So, when you, how did you get your first cab registered? And how did you convince them to pay you 10% after the transaction happens rather than an app?
So essentially when we started in June, right, we were lucky because that was the non-season, right? April, May is the season where people get a lot of vacations, people travel and stuff. So when we started, we went into that non-season bit and we told them, these people, that we'll give you customers and you don't have to pay us anything upfront, right? So then people thought, okay, it's a non-season, we don't have to pay anything upfront. What is that we are going to lose, right? So when they said that, so we realized that the peak is, well, season is going to start from October. Like June, July, August, we work very hard to essentially ensure that all the operators understand what is the pay rate. Like once we get that, then it becomes a lot more smoother. October, November, December become a lot more smoother. That's how we went about doing it.
Hello, did you get the money from
them?
Like, were you paid money from
them?
Like, so
it was really simple because we started with the 100 per day, got into 5 trips per day, 10 trips per day, right? And we had access to more number of operators than the customers. So if who were paid, they used to get more customers. Right? And it was used to, so if you don't pay, fine, don't pay, because we don't know how to generate more customers yet. Right? So we used to give it to who were paid. So then all the people wanted to pay. Right? Now we have essentially gone to the model of people pay, they put in some deposit and we get it.
First, you started with a 10%, that is a margin. How do you believe that that's a thing which you can live with? That is the money which you can live with.
So, this is a very, very interesting point. I think this is where the business knowledge really comes, right? We can easily take, because of the kind of business that we drive, right? So, we drive anywhere between 95 to 98% of the business for our taxi operators, right? We can easily move that 10% to 15% or 20% also. Easily. And the operators will be willing to pay because they've seen that kind of a growth and stuff like that. The moment we get into that 20% and stuff like that, right, we leave room open for someone to enter at 10%. Right? The market hasn't really matured yet where operators are trying to some of our operators, right? We keep it stick to the 10% so that it doesn't make any economic sense for anyone to come and undercut. Right? The moment people start undercutting, instead of we, all of us, start Uber, Ola and us, instead of developing the industry, what will happen is, we will only pull the industry down. Right? And that is not going to help anyone. Right? And that's essentially what. So we essentially keep it to that 10% so that we don't get anyone. So once we get into the measures there, then we do it.
In your case, an individual taxi driver is your direct customer, taxi operator. If a guy owns a travel agency, let's say he has got 10 minutes, so your individual apps goes to almost 20 drivers. But who is your customer? Is the driver or the customer? 20 drivers?
So we keep three people as a customers. The passenger in the car, the taxi operator that we work with, and the driver. We treat all the three of them as customers.
Can a taxi company, like say one of these Bharti or Friendstack, Fasttrack is too good. Let's take somewhere. You take those guys also as your customer.
We work with Million Dots. We work with Million Dots and the French Taxi in Chennai.
So all the drivers have your apps.
So Million Dot has done is they've given 75 of the 200 cars that they have for the thing. So essentially they are essentially placing cars in. Right. So it makes sense for 25. From 25 we move to 50. Currently as we speak now we are at 75. So eventually just a matter of time we'll get to that 200 mark.
So what is that? I call Million Dots also and directly go, in which case they are free to write them.
Yes, that's my
if the call comes through you, we would.
Yes, so whenever they are free, they can switch on our device. Right? So then if there is a customer nearby, they get it and they have a choice to accept it. So, it would really work. There's no exclusivity per se.
So, I have a couple of questions. I think it's my biggest challenge. How do you, as in, I've thought of, you know, see it online, newspaper ads, but
How big is your company?
We are about 60 people.
Then I need reference, primary reference. And the reference also works beautifully. But you need to incentivize the reference. There ain't no such thing as freelance. People are not going to refer for me. A transcriber doesn't work at all. Right? Another transcriber is the universal truth. There ain't no such thing as freelance. So you incentivize people, right? And once you, so no one wants to recommend someone who is probably a not so great person and sit along with them at work. Right? So you don't, your interview process also, timelines gets crunched, the culture fitness happened, and you don't want to spend any energies on training those people because the friend only will train. Yeah, this is not the way to do, man, this is the way to do this. Right? And you don't want to spend some energy. So if, whatever the money that you pay for the reference, right, that essentially gets amortized across multiple levels, right? Culture fitness happens, training happens, right? And you don't have to even interview timelines also, you don't have to do multiple rounds of interview, everything comes out, right? The reference is the way to really go, that's one. Second thing is LinkedIn, right? Use LinkedIn very, very extensively. Use LinkedIn extensively, right? That's really important. And you need to talk in startup communities. Right, and essentially you have to keep talking about your startup, right? There are a bunch of people who would have started something but things would not be going anywhere, right? So they would be in that brain where they don't know do this or do that, and those will be that people would have started, those people will be the exceptional people, right? And if they find that, if they start believing in your vision and your dream, very high probability that they'd come and join you. Right. So that you have to talk whenever you get an opportunity, you have to talk about your company, your vision, your dream, right? And that's essential things about. And as I said, references is very important. And also certain accelerators, right, where you go talk to people if things are not really working fine with sponsor company, right, talk to them, get them on board. People always need a way out. And someone has to essentially help them out. So you wait for people to come and approach you. Might be difficult. I'm not saying that it may not happen. Might be difficult. But when you start approaching different people, right, you'll get a lot of people.
My second question is about market research. When you say you spent 1 year trying to figure out the market, I find that a difficult exercise. How do you go about it? Know what is the market. I mean, for one thing to know about is, you know, these reports and go through market research companies, but I don't know whether that's what you did or did you go on to the field then?
So we did a field exercise. And I think that's very, very critical because some of the questions the investors ask, right, the confidence in which you answer them would only come if you are on the field asking those questions to the customers, right? You wouldn't have picked all those things in whatever report that you would have created for yourself, but because you had that quality of interaction with those customers, right, that makes a significant difference. And when a VC is asking you probing questions, because they just want to understand how deep is your thought process in that, right? But then the confidence in which you answer, right, that shows. And that sets people who are banked on someone else's idea, someone else's dream, with someone who has actually dreamt it and would want to really do it. And that's the difference. And that's essentially what people look for. Otherwise, people copy somebody else's idea, come and do this, makes sense, I can get a website faster because I'm a tech guy. Right? But if they haven't really done that research and that quality, right, it shows. And that's essentially what the VC also really looks at. Right? One has to do that market. I know it's boring, right? Trust me, 90 to 95% of the work that I don't like today. Right? Because I'm a product guy. And I love developing products. I love that. But now, right, so I have a call after this, right, at 10:30, and I have a call because I need to probably resolve some ego clash between two of my businesses. That's not something that I want to do at 10:30 in the night. But I have to do it. I don't know how long will it take. right? But yeah, there are a lot of things that one has to do that we don't like to do. But everything is for the company. Right? So, you guys have kids? You have a kid? Right? I have a kid, right? That cute smile, that innocence is only 5% of the time. 95% of the time is changing diapers, right? Listening to him crying, right? But yeah, that 5% is worth it. Right, it's all worth it. And that's a way to really look at life in general also.
Do you still, are you on, like, you know, your detail level
of
product? You started coding. How difficult was it to transition when you started scaling up, like, you know, 5 to 30 and I'm still a little bit. So I'm seeing the company moving to different space now. So how is that actually? Like, the whole scaling apart, being hands-on at a point, and you moving into a totally way, as you said, 95% of the time, you're doing something else.
It's a tough question to answer. Let me give an example. How many people follow TV series here? Game of Thrones. People follow TV series, Game of Thrones, Suits, Breaking Bad, right? How I Met Your Mother and stuff like that. You guys follow. So when you start off, it is like watching the entire one episode of Game of Thrones in one shot, right? Watching How I Met Your Mother in whatever the 20 minutes or something like that, and probably Suits up one after the other. Right? Once you get to a particular scale, you watch Game of Thrones for half an hour, you watch 10 minutes of How I Met Your Mother, and you watch half an hour of Suits, and then half an hour of the remaining of Game of Thrones, and again How I Met Your Mother, and stuff like that. And once you again get to 10 minutes of Game of Thrones, 2 minutes of How I Met Your Mother, and 10 minutes of Suits, but you still have to get the story right. Right? And you have to connect, and that's the kind of context which in that really happens. Right? You still follow the story because you've seen that 1 hour, 60 minutes thing in 6 different parts at different levels, but you still have to stitch the story right. Right? And that's essentially how it
One follow-up question on that is how the product is evolving. Like you must have your opinion and your
So that's where, so one
speed and the breadth of that aspect.
See, I think there, right, so my personal experience has been you'll always find that if you were doing that, you would have done it faster. You always feel that if you have done it, you would have done it faster. The first year, things were like running out so fast. We did from spreadsheet to this in overnight. And now we're just adding, changing the color from yellow to orange takes 1 week. And we built the entire system overnight. Now it takes 1 week. You always go through that, right? I don't know how many people have experienced. And that is something that we need to internalize. You just don't have a choice, but we need to internalize, right? Then you essentially play that, okay, fine. Because see, the most constrained resource in an individual's life is time, right? Money can be raised easily, right? Whatever money there are people, but no one is going to give you time. Right? The time that is lost, right? The only way to maximize time, right, when you have in the 24 hours is, you need to get people who can do things the way you do it and get more of those people. If you get two of such kind of people, your 24 hours, instead of, it will not become 72 hours, it will at least go up to 40 hours, right? Get more number of those people, that 40 hours becomes 60 hours. And that's how you multiply time, right? Money is fixed. If you get the right set of people, the time becomes infinite. So we have a choice. Either we look at time as the most constrained resource, or we look at time as the most flexible resource, right? And you get the right people, empower them, and tell them you essentially share that vision. Okay, this is what we want to achieve as part of Taxi for Sure, right? This is essentially what it happens. And they will make mistakes. Let them make mistakes. Right? You can do it faster, but you are not building scale. You are not building capacity. You are only constraining yourself. The more you constrain, the more you take on your plate, that 24 hours becomes, how long can you survive? 1 year, 2 years, 3 years? Beyond that, no. But you need to build capacity. Build that room. And then people only will come back to that, okay, we can do this also. Then you say, oh, then you know that, okay, we have arrived because the next level of people are there. And you don't have to read it. That's how really you want to go about doing it.
We've been talking about sharing open doors. That's good. But I also like to know what through your mind, right? What are those things you would like to keep confidential? I mean, there are things that
all the pain, all the sorrows.
VCs do. I have been told that VCs generally they keep their opinion in themselves. So, everybody has their share of things that they can offer. So as an entrepreneur, what would be those things that they should keep confidential and share when only that is necessary?
So it depends within the team or outside the team, with the investors or...
Yeah, you, it's an open question.
With the team, I think as far as the business is concerned, essentially you have to share everything. Being open and transparent takes the entire company to a completely different level altogether. Right? The more we close, the people feel that you are not trusting them enough. And when the trust question comes, everything is lost. But having said that, you can't share everything. Right? So the, as I told you, right, the pain, the sorrow, right, that has to really not perfect. To go to a VC, the VC would essentially make you feel that this is the completely screwed up business model. Right? You can't come and share that with them. Right? You need to sit back and relax and do that. Right? And you are running out of cash. How do you essentially do that? Right? How do you go? And you are going through certain personal thing at home. You just can't go and share that. Right? The company probably, there is a litigation against your company. Right, and you have no idea how to deal with it. Right? Don't share it. Right? The thought of all of such things really, really comes. Right? You need to do that. Right? And VCs, the most fundamental reaction is exaggerate. They just exaggerate everything. Right? If the company is showing some trend, they feel that, oh, this is the next big thing. If the company is showing some lower trend, they feel that, oh, shit, this is going up on the drain. So exaggerate, right? So unless one is confident that, okay, we know what exactly we are doing, don't share that. Unless we know what is really happening. If you don't know, you just can't go or sit with the VC and something, the things are showing the download code, but I have no idea. Then they would only bias your mind with what all the things that would be going on. Right? So unless you are clear, you don't really go on that. So you need to, so essentially, from the way I would really look at my job now, because I don't really do any functional stuff anymore. I meet people. If I feel that the person is good, even though I don't really have any relevant thing, we get them on board, right? Empower them. And my job is, if there are any hurdles that they're facing, remove those hurdles. And first, don't do anything else in the company. Get people, empower them, remove hurdles. Right? Hurdles will be those, whatever the pain. But as far as the company is concerned, the vision is concerned, the dream is concerned, sharing always helps. Right? And you never know where helps, which quarter you will get the help from.
So, there is always a big company say fast,
right? Right? They come up with an app,
so, you know,
all
customers
will
take the app. So, how do you manage
the things? Very good question. So, Crossword was big, Flipkart became big. What is that they didn't do right? They could have also started an e-commerce portal. Right? So similarly, now Meru has also started. Fastrack has also. Does that mean that we have lost anything? No. See, it all depends on the DNA of the company. And that's the reason where the culture is really, really important. Right? So the DNA of the Landmark guys were build retail stores. Selling books with touch and feel kind of an experience, not on the retail, not on the e-commerce portal, right? So changing the DNA of the company takes a lot, right? The on the top, the let's say the faster CEO thinks that, okay, we need to develop an app, right? And we would do X percent of the bookings through the app only. By the time it percolates to the guy who's managing the call center, it's lost because of the different levels. So once you become that big elephant, right, it's very, very difficult to dance. So you need to be very, very agile and you need to be very, very, right, that's essentially how it is. It's not really easy to change the DNA of the company. Right, very difficult to do that.
How much do you control the price point of the car, the
rent,
how much it charges?
See, we don't really control the price point person because we are an aggregator, we are more of a marketplace. Whatever is the prices that are prevalent, whatever the prices the operators are doing, it's essentially what we reflect. Right? We don't really control that particular price point. But if there are ways where we think that a particular price point is going to help the supply side, a particular price point is going to help the demand side, which are compromising either of the side. Right? Then we go and essentially talk to the operators, and if they agree to that, that's essentially agree to that. Right? So we don't really do those free range and stuff.
Initially,
you wouldn't take anything from the cap levels.
How do you make sure they are accountable for anything? They
might
dropping and
properly
dropping the customers are
answered in the calls. Interesting question. Depending on how do we drive service levels, is what you are trying to ask, right? So, the way we really look at this is the kind of association that taxi operators have with taxi for sure is the kind of association that a taxi operator has with a corporate. Let's say some IBM, Maxim, and stuff like that, right? So IBM, let's say IBM, right? If they have to employ IBM who needs the offset program in the morning, when they take a cab to go home, right? Those are not your typical middle fast night, right? So they have it's with a local operator, with a local driver, right? And an employee, let's say a female employee for IBM, she's taking the cab at 2 a.m. Will she feel insecure? Not necessarily. Will she even think twice to get into the cab? Not necessarily, because she knows that the cab is coming from IBM. The same local operator is the same local driver. Why the local operator and that local driver will provide that kind of a service level with that particular individual, but not with general people? Because they will have surety business. Right? And that's the surety. So even though, let's say, a local operator working with IBM, right, probably they will be doing around 40 to 50 trips a day. Right? Because they don't want to lose out on it, so that's the reason they provide good service levels. Right? So, as taxi for sure, if we start working with the taxi operator, right, probably we may start with 5 trips per day. As taxi for sure starts growing, we start getting it to 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. Then we are at par with the IBM clients. Right? The kind of service levels that a company like IBM enjoys, that's the kind of service level that we enjoy. And we don't stop there. What we do is we tell the people what is good service levels and how we train them on how to go about delivering that. Right? We hope. Right, and the way we dispatch also, right? If there are, say, there are two or three cabs we charge equidistant from that particular customer, the cab that gets that particular customer is the one which have got better customer rating from customers, right? And we essentially communicate that to all the drivers also, so that they know that, okay, customer service we provide, the amount of business that they would make would also increase, right? And then there is competition for that, right? I'm a 5-star driver, you're just 4.5. Right, you are looking at let's say Candy Crush. I don't know how many people play Candy Crush. People say, I'm at 98. What stage are you? You are at only 72. You have to pick up, right? And that's essentially what we do with, right? And it's a rolling window. Right? So, people who have done some great service level 6 months back, they can't pass in that glory. It's the last 30 days window. In the last 30 days, what has been your customer rating based on that window? So someone has messed up experience, it will probably have an impact for the next 29 days. Not beyond. Someone has done a great customer service, will impact this one for the next 29 minutes. It's a rolling window, and that's how we essentially keep it.
So, for example, in taxi culture, getting taxi at time, I would be much more happy that if I can share the taxi with some other person who is starting at the same point.
Are you referring to carpooling?
Yes.
Carpooling is an idea that we are working on, I think, but it's still very long stage. See, 50% of our market is wiped out because a woman would never share a car with a guy.
So you can get an option like
someone,
what gender you want to share
a car. So we are doing certain experiments there. So we are essentially now on the carpooling side, right? So we're working with some students, the 10th and the 12th and students, so who essentially go to a tuition early in the morning, instead of their parents picking up, so they do currently one parent picks up those 3 kids one day, the next parent picks up the 3 kids the next day. So they're looking at that market and essentially getting those, because at least those 3 students know each other and they're going to the same location, right? So there are certain operations challenges. The first day woke up late, the second and third day are panicking because they don't want to miss the class, right? So there are certain operations challenges that we're working on, right? Even though all 3 of them know each other and stuff like that, the onus lies on taxi for sure to ensure that the first day makes up on time, right? And we are essentially solving those operational challenges, right? Those will come up, but we are working on that.
Idea to action, how do you get out of your comfort zone and
you quit your job, right? When you're used to a salary, you quit your job, and when you don't get your salary and you are leaving off your spouse's money, and the spouse essentially makes you feel that you are leaving off that money, you get to action soon.
How do you manage incidences like
your drivers engineering, with your customers? What is the accountability or how you have managed?
So, sir, so the decrease of expenses, right? So, someone overcharges, let's say, 50 rupees or something, for whatever reason, toll charges and stuff like that, right? They get a warning, right? Second time they do something like that, they get suspended for 2 days and with a fine penalty. Third time they do it, they're out of the system. Right? That depends on the kind of offense, right? It's the same guy overcharging 50 bucks, but if it's a major thing where there is a rude behavior on the driver, right? For the first instance, only we will remove them from the thing and would ensure that all the drivers would do that. Right? And also, what we are trying to build is we are building small communities of drivers, five drivers, right? Amount of businesses those five drivers would get is a function of cumulative customer rating. Right? And then the other four drivers only will ensure that the fifth driver would behave well. Because, see, I don't know, so all the fifth people are studying in colleges and stuff like that, right? There's going to be a bad prof, right? So this guy, you code for a guy and the prof essentially scores this person and stuff like that. This person says something, right? So you'll be thrown out of the class and stuff like that. That will happen. But all the friends said, you did an awesome job. You essentially took his case. That's essentially is the thing, right? But if we essentially make a bunch of people, 5 or 6 people, who's probably the grade depends on how that guy behaves, then you guys will only essentially ensure that the guy behaves well. Than essentially taking that, right? So the people would mention, that customer did something like that to me, I essentially did this to that customer, they're like, oh yeah, you did the right thing. But essentially, if you essentially make the other 4 people suffer for that guy's behavior, they would only figure out multiple ways to ensure that this driver behaves like people. Right? And that's essentially, that's all that micro community. This is something learning that we had from the microfinance tool.
This is one thing which I experienced when I was working in Fast Track. So I moved from one city to another city. The driver who drove me inside the city limit was different, and once he crossed the city limit, someone else changed, saying that they were brothers or something like that.
Yeah, got that thing actually. So once there was a Harish guy, his brother Faisal to the customer. I don't know how Harish brother is Faisal. right? I mean, they just use the same story, but yeah. So sorry, what's the question?
So how do you address it? One driver
misbehaves,
he gets out of the system and
uses
another driver's
credentials. So, the way we do that is, the cab details, the vehicle number, the insurance copy and stuff like that is tied to the driver's phone number and the driver license number and stuff like that. Okay? If those things get mismatched, right? So we have an inspection team, we inspect everything. If those things get mismatched, then they're committed analysis. So essentially what we do is, one is to identify issues which the customers report. Another thing is to essentially figure out issues before the customer reports on and essentially plug them at the source. That's essentially how we do it.
Yeah, I have a question on partnership. So when you, let's say you are focusing on one market, one region, say Canada, people, you talk to the customers in their local language, you will get more traction, more interaction with them. So, but how do you manage? You're putting some, let's say I am running a service, I just want to recruit different regions. Actually, in the Asia market, everybody is running on their own local system. So if I want to partnership with them, how can I approach them? How to get into that local?
Looking at how to essentially get into a new geography, or how do you decide which geography to enter into?
Because we don't have any visibility on what they became, what their culture. So, we don't have any visibility, so how can I...
So, interesting, stuff like that would really happen when you essentially are at a particular size, right? So, where you have some money, right? So, those are the times when you can essentially fall back on other companies which have essentially gone into those geographies, right? So, when we entered Chennai, right, we didn't know what kind of marketing strategy would work for Chennai. The Google AdWords for the taxi keyword and the cab keyword, the trends, right, were very, very low. So online marketing wouldn't have been the case, right? And when we did some initial research, we figured out that OLX had essentially taken over the Chennai market. The next thing that we did was, we couldn't reach out to the OLX guys. We spoke to the marketing agency which OLX worked with when they took Chennai, right? And started engaging in conversations. We don't know why did OLX did this, what was the thought process, and then the marketing agencies essentially shared the whole thing. right? And that's essentially how it. So if you are in the services sector or in the, let's say in a B2B segment, right, there are other companies who have gone and established presence there. So one has to talk to those people to really figure out what are the kind of regulations that really happens, what are the kind of network that really happens, and I think the nature, the kind of at least the stage at which India is in, right, we would find people who would have been in almost all the countries across the world.
Your
event code is still cash. So, is there any plan? You are planning to move to cash? September 14th.
What is significance in that?
No, we told. So, we use cash payment. Is there any way to pay by credit card or something? We're launching it on September 14th. This one.
I wanted to book a cab last week for a half day trip. So I started booking it too. And the earliest time slot they could offer me was 5. And so because there was another operator who was giving me a 2:10, there was a cab at my room. But taxi for sure couldn't be there.
This was in Chennai?
Yeah, it was in
Chennai. So we are ramping up the supply in Chennai. There are certain challenges in Chennai which we are trying to address.
You said you.
You just had an idea, quit your job, and after that, only you had 2 days. Don't you have a housing loan? My wife works. My wife works. But thankfully, we didn't really have anything of that kind. So, liability is something a balance sheet has to match. Like, no point in taking up liabilities, we don't have the assets to match. So we decided instead of taking the liabilities, we thought we'll first create the assets, then take liabilities. And people typically take liabilities and then start looking at how to build up the assets. That's essentially the way we are looking at. See, the thing is, what we decided was to give ourselves 2 years. We were 29, 2 years would be 31, right? And as a consultant, what I figured out was, we were doing this in both Apple, we were doing basic jobs in the previous companies. If things wouldn't have really worked out, right? There are multiple times things have failed, and we would have essentially put in all our effort to essentially ensure that we don't fail, right? Even despite that good of failing, then we would have learned a lot more in those 2 years than if I continued as a consultant in those 2 years, right? Then if I go back to become a consultant, I would be a much better consultant than what I used to be, right? If it would have worked out, I would have been sitting here and talking to this, right? And that's essentially how we go. So we gave ourselves 2 years, right? And parents were fine, wife was fine, most importantly.
So one question, competitors, so let's say plenty of competitors, so should I listen to them or should I follow my path? I mean, so they are also releasing their versions, they are also releasing their new features. Should I compete in the sense, or should I sample them, should I
the same feature whatever they have, or should I, okay, I have this vision, my path should go with this, so I just stick with my path. So, do you have any strategy on listening them, and do reacting with them? See, so, very, very relevant question. See, a straightforward answer to it is, you need to know what you have to
decide,
right? So, you follow cricket, you understand cricket? You understand cricket, right? So, in test matches, right, so, one team takes, let's say, 4 fast bowlers, only 1 spinner. Other team takes 2 fast bowlers, 3 spinners. Which is the right strategy? Only time will tell, right? Just because the opposition took 4 fast bowlers and only 1 spinner, you also take 4 fast bowlers and 1 spinner, the track turns out to be a spinning track. Whose responsibility is it? It's again your responsibility, because you made a decision, but you didn't believe in it. But you commit and you can't blame anyone else. But if you make the wrong decision, getting 3 spinners on a fast track match, you would essentially end up like India. Right? That will always be there. But you need to really know, you need to probably understand what the customers really want and cater to that bit. Right? And essentially set yourself things up. But either which things go, right? You are the only person who is going to be accountable and you have to know that. Right? So we want to be accountable for something that you believe in. Or do you want to be accountable for something that somebody else believes in? That's the choice that you make. And that's completely under your control. That's how you need to look at it.
Two questions, if you don't mind. First off, like when you get a lot of VCs on board, right? And yeah, congrats for raising a lot of money, but aren't you bothered by the fact that you know you might lose independence as say you know the guy running the ship pretty much? Like if VCs get too involved, like I mean, just out of curiosity, right? At what stage do they really get involved with this problem? Like at what stage do say founders lose power of you know in their own company, etc.? That's the first question. Second off, like you know, you spoke about Uber before, but with respect to Ola Caps specifically, right? And they're a Indian operator and everything. Do they bother you? Like, you know, what's your plan to you know, sort of deal with localized competition?
Okay. First question, so we are a Series A funded company, so we don't, as founders, we don't hold 50%. We just hold less than 50%. So we don't really have official control, right? The thing about the board is, if things are going fine, no one will disturb you, right? So, just like parents, right? You go to college, you essentially get those grades, right? You go drink, get drunk, you get sloshed. I don't think so your parents are going to do anything. You come home on time and stuff like that, you start drinking, your parents will have a problem. You understood? So it all depends on what are the results, right? As long as you are committed to something and you are delivering those, I don't think so anyone would do that. So essentially, I'm not saying that look up to the visas as parents or stuff like that. People would interfere only when they think that something is not going in the right way. Right? If they feel that things are going the right way, people would not really, right? However, so if you stay in a joint family, right, your uncle, aunts typically get involved in that. But yeah, your uncles and your siblings and parents and stuff like that, right? You don't really do that, right? That's one. The second thing when it comes to the local competition, we would have been very happy if we had more people than just Ola's competition, because the industry has to improve, right? And so far, at least, it's good that we have Ola, right? And they're doing a lot of great things, right? And a lot of good things also, so that the industry itself is getting matured and stuff like that. And most importantly, they are keeping us around toes, right? If Ola wouldn't have been there, would we have done the current fundraise? I don't know. If they wouldn't, if a local competition wouldn't have been there, would we have been so agile, so into this, and had this kind of a better understanding of the market? We don't know, right? But it's good that they are there. Right, and competition is always good, right? And now people talk about this. If we were the only guys, right, we would have been probably someone who no one would really know, right? So some people are like, now people understand what is that we do because of competition, right? Uber exists, Ola exists, okay, taxi versus, how are they different? Then people want to get more deeper into it, okay, this space. Who are the other people? No one really knows what is really happening in this space. If there was another social networking platform, which was also equally good. Then people want to get, how is Facebook different from that? Then they understand, oh, this is good, this is great, oh, Facebook is doing something like this, this is good. And then people start appreciating some of the product features and stuff like that. Right? If you don't have competition, even though you're doing some kickaster, people have no idea that you're doing all that. Because people think that you have monopoly. Flipkart is doing monopoly. Flipkart is doing a number of new things. Flipkart is Flipkart is there. Now Amazon has come. People didn't know that Flipkart started COD, or people know that. That is a phenomenal shift in the Indian ecosystem. Because they didn't really have any competition which was not doing that, because always they lost out, that COD hasn't really become the big thing. That's essentially, it's a huge jump. It's a revolution in the Indian e-commerce industry. So because they didn't have competition, they don't really feel that it is that. They essentially conquered the market that way. So competition is always good.
See, since you've been in this industry, take fast track, they have a lot of cars. All of them are attached. Right? They are not owning those cars. But if you drill down to say a smaller operator like Run Taxi or so, these guys are here also you can go and attach your taxi. But they need to have their own cars. So to raise capital, what they do is they say, you give some money, you share some. Monthly they give you the profit out. But the car is in your name. But it's sorry, in their name. It's registered in their name or whatever, right? They give you a separate dealer. They do a they have their the car is in their name, but they put their So I don't understand the trade-off here. A larger operator like FastTrack, or even a mid-sized operator like FastTrack, like say some other like French track, they're not asking you like give me the money or they want you to attach their cars, it's not it. Whereas when you drill down to the smaller operators, not so small, few hundred cars or so, they want to grow by owning more cars. But why is this? How is this? I mean, I'm not able to understand why this trade-off somewhere is opposite behaviors.
See, it all depends on what is the mentality in which the management committee is, right? So when FastTrack started, they were owning the cars. Once they started expanding, right? There are more number of people who want to become part of the network because they were the only ones who would give them business. Right? Once they figured out this is the business, right? And since they have the share monopoly, they would go into that fixed pay and stuff like that, right? So now that has essentially become a deterrent, more as a deterrent for them because they get the fixed pay every month, irrespective of the amount of business that they provide to the drivers. Right? There is no incentive for FastTrack to push. But someone like us who works completely on variable, right? We make money only when you make money. Then there is an incentive for us to push. And everyone wants to earn more.
In
right?
your case, you are just a service provider. You are working on a totally different level. But I'm talking about what's happening at those who are actually operating those capital intensive, those cars. There is a four different pull and push between those guys. Somebody wants to go with attachments and somebody wants to own more.
See, it all depends on who do they work with. If the guy who is working with corporate, where the service level holds a significant key, that is the person who wants to invest in cars.
Wants to own the
cars. He wants to own the cars because he wants them in the service levels. But someone who is essentially attaching because of some just-tell model or some other retail model and stuff like that, right? They don't really mind so much on the service levels. Then it's more of scale, rapid scale, growth. That's essentially how they would look at it. It all depends on which is the customer that you're trying to serve.
I've got a question for the farm industry. They have an issue with the huge food, so it's quite interesting to hear your proximity that you did not get. Being through your asset light, cash generating business. Now, how do you convince yourself that it's okay, let me dilute myself to whatever?
Sir, give you a cliche answer. Owning 100% of a 10 lakh company is not really good in your, if you can own 10% of a 1000 crore company.
Yeah, but it comes at a cost of control, right?
No, sir, as a
total. No business is going to be good always.
See, the cost of control could essentially happen. See, if you own more than 50% also, right, the least you can pull up. You can't stop that. They can't decide what you have to do and stuff like that when it comes to a board vote. But if it gets to that stage, then something is already compromised. Right? So when it comes to a vote, just because you want to show that you are the 51% holder, then something is already compromised and there is not much. Right? So they may not be able to influence it as much, right? But they can pull up. You can't stop because even though you hold 51%, you can't stop them. Right? That's. And even though you vote less than 50% also, it doesn't really mean that they would start interfering. They will start interfering only when it really happens, right? For that, one has to, when you're getting the VC on board or the PE on board, you need to do a significant amount of research. You have to speak to the people whom they are invested in and get their feedback also. And you need to ask the right questions because no one wants to say bad things about people, right? And one thing that we need to differentiate here is, VC is a VC. The person on the board is an individual, right? Assuming that the VC is going to behave this way because the VC has done these things, and extrapolating the same thing to the individual would be a very wrong thing to do, right? So one is we need to do some research on the VC per se, and one has to do research on the who is the one who's going to come on the board, because you are not going to be discussing with the VC, the firm as the VC in a board meeting, but you will be discussing with that individual. The way that particular individual behaves is what is much more important, right? And that's essentially what is, right? And dilution is not something that one has to really worry about, right? Because if you undercommit over deliver, right, the next round of funding will essentially take care of this, right? Again, you undercommit and over deliver the next round, right? It's always better to be that where your essential things gets, you gain a lot of things in the next round and next round, than essentially over-committing and under-delivering it then your own VC is not supporting you. Right? If you undercommit and work together, your VC will only get you a lot of other VCs and PEs. So they will be doing part of your job. Right? But if you overcommit and under deliver, they themselves are not so convinced that this is going to something that is going to work. Right? And that's essentially how it has related to work. Right? It's a call that you take. You want to essentially see that money in the mirror piling up, or you want to have that peaceful sleeping in solid funds. It's all about choices.
Just to interrupt, we have time for maybe a couple more questions at the most.
Was it a conscious decision to not micromanage and empower the new management person? That could be a difference in philosophy. That could be a lot of things that you were not aware of.
Great question.
Why does it pay off?
See, it's a great question. See, if you are essentially getting a great bunch of people on board, right, and if you are going to micromanage them, they are not like it. And you are going to lose those people. What's the whole point of getting a great bunch of people and you have to micromanage them? Why would they even stick? Then you don't need that kind of people. You need someone who is probably 2 or 3 levels below industry level. Right? So you get those people, you need to empower them. Right? But if you make a hiring mistake, it comes in bites. Right? Then you need to really have to know when to make the call that, okay, he's not the right person. Right? So hiring is not the biggest challenge in this. Letting go is. Alright, and I guess most of you are South Indians here. It's so very difficult for a South Indian. We jump to getting into relationships. Getting out of a relationship is so difficult for us. Right? And the challenge, because everyone is going to help you in hiring. Your employees are going to refer people, right? Your investors, your friends are going to put people. No one is going to help you when you have to let go. And you are alone. Just alone. No one is going to help you when you have to get home. Right? And people are going to make life difficult when you have to get home. Right? Why did that person go? Because not all the people have the kind of visibility that you have on that particular person. Right? Letting go of people is the most challenging within a startup. It's very, very difficult. And so it means it's much, much. I'm not being racist here and stuff like that. And because of the way we put this thing, right? It's so very difficult for us to get out of the relationship. And you feel that, oh, this person will improve, this person will improve, this person will improve. And that's not really happening. So you would step, try to do their work, you would step, try to do their work, you would step, try to do their work. How long would you do in your work? The opportunity cost of you not doing your work and doing other person's work, you have no idea what it cost. And that is something that would be.
How many co-founders you have got?
Me and my partner, from both of us.
So you are maintaining the same, like, When you
employ
more people, you will not find that.
So we have given ESOPs to people, stakes to people, yeah. But as founders, only have 2 or 3.
So when you started,
you
would have seen certain opportunity, and
right?
Now you are
So when we started, we just wanted to be better than a single biggest operator in terms of availability of taxis, right? After some time, we realized that every L-O-Pod vehicle should be on the Taxi for Sure platform, right? So now we are at a stage, every 4-wheeler that is manufactured should be on the Taxi for Sure platform, because people should not want to own any personal cars, right? So essentially, that's how, so your thinking also evolves for a bit of time, right? The dreams become bigger.
Probably that's it. Are you like tying up with, say, Tata Motors?
We work with Tata Motors, Maruti, Mahindra, Toyota to help our operators get things in its control state. Stuff like that. And even free service delivery as well. And free technical drivers training also. So they do all that.
Only tractors
are
there.
Sorry?
Only tractors are
there. Are you planning for diversification from your main? Like,
do you have any plans for diversification? Sure. If you look at about this page on the taxiposure.com website, right? So this, I think that was penned by Apu when we started. So when we started Taxi for Sure, we thought that we'll have more for sure brands, hotels for sure, deals for sure, and all those things. So that's essentially what we thought. Okay, once we have the technology which is more on aggregator, the same technology can be used for multiple different segments and stuff like that, right? our taxi business is just so busy that we pursue three for sure. Right, and that's once you get into that things, once you get your hands ready, right, it gets earlier and earlier when you know that there's a lot of stuff happening, then you just can't do it, because you just have to, you have to hold your home turf. Right, and that's essentially what happens.
Yeah, actually I have a question. This is what is the right time to form these kind of teams? Because very rarely it will work out. But when I grow it, okay, after 2 years I should have these teams in my hand. After 5 years I have these teams in my hand. So how can I get that?
So, good question. So, typically what will happen is if you don't really have those teams, you would be doing that. Right? And if you, the day you feel that you are wasting a lot of time in doing these sundry activities and your time is much more valuable and invested somewhere else, that's the time you start planning, building those connections, right? If you are handling finances on your own, right? And instead of essentially working on your product or getting into a sales meeting, you're essentially sitting and reimbursing bills. Right, then you know that you are essentially losing money. That's essentially you need to get an accounts person and stuff like that. Similarly, if you are getting more time is getting involved in day-to-day operation stuff, because of which you are not able to focus on the next month or the next quarter kind of things, right? Then you need to get an operations manager who will take care of the day-to-day stuff so that you get to that. Right? It all depends on, so the way we need to do this, so as entrepreneurs, we have to do both micro and macro. And the more you are getting into micro, then you more need to know that, okay, you need to get someone for the micro. Because no one can take macro out of you. Macro is something that your responsibility. Micro is something that can be handled. So you need to figure out in a day how much time are you spending on the micro things, how much time are you spending on the macro things. And the moment you see that most of the time is getting into micro things, and that's when you start building that capability inside.
Okay, how do you commute actually? Do you use taxi for sure and do you live your dream?
Yeah, we do that. And